Hello, welcome back to Let's Play Interactively Play Steve Jackson Sorcery. I'm the RPG chick, still recovering. Having some tea with honey. Okay, so it was tied. If my episode had gone on up on the next Monday, like as planned, we would have been completely tied, but in the meantime I did get another vote to wait. So we're tied between wait and try and escape here. Refreshing our memory. You take a seat on the other bench from the old man who is fussing with his empty sleeve. You turn to face the old man. Tell me how I can escape this place. Oh, it's simple enough, he replies. In a day or two, the guards will let you out. Once they've decided you're not an enemy, they just take a while to consult one of the mages. And if I don't want to wait? The old man shrugs. Then you cast a spell and get that door open. You are a sorceress, aren't you? I hope I haven't got locked up with a normal. You stand from the bench once more. So for those who don't know, I am still recovering from a bout with laryngitis. On the mend here, and my voice is sounding better every day. Just a little shaky right now, but close to my normal pitch, as has been in weeks. So, with two votes for trying and escape, three votes for waiting, we're gonna wait. I'm in no hurry, you declare. You settle down to wait. Hours pass, but the guards do not return. Night falls, and you stretch out on the floor to rest. No doubt when the guards come in the morning, you will be able to persuade them of your innocence. You have already eaten today, so you are quite comfortable. Soon you are feeling sleepy. Across the room, the old man is already dozing, or pretending to doze, wrapped in his rags. Can you afford to sleep? What if he attacks you overnight? Or what if the guards come? Let's stay awake, then. You sit up all night, but nothing happens. The guards are quite happy to leave you to rot, and the old man sleeps soundly. Strange thoughts? Strange thoughts besiege you in the night. You imagine the wall, like a towering monster, drenched in moss and slime, the gate, its wide-open maw. Meanwhile, the one-armed prisoner throws the knuckles of his missing hand onto the bench over and over, calling endlessly to himself. And it is as though you could see the crown sitting in the dust on the far side of the north gate, so close and yet out of reach. By morning you are thoroughly exhausted. Okay, the next morning. Sunrise comes eventually, and with it, the guards. They open the door and leave it propped, without explanation. The old man is out in a flash, and you emerge behind him. So they're letting us both out. At the main street, he turns right away from a barracks. Then he reaches another junction and turns right again. Okay, so right, and then right. Or right. Well, the only place to go is this junction. At the end of the yard, the road splits. Looking left, you see the guard lined up in rows, running drills. Best not to head that way. To the right, the road leads towards the first buildings of Kharé. Yeah, we can't head that way, even if we wanted to. You follow the road away from the yard, along the bottom of a cliff edge. Let's look up at the cliff. Kharé is built on a series of natural steps. In the past, the river flooded every autumn, drenching the land and keeping it fertile. But since the city was raised and the river dammed, the floods have stopped. Now the trees look thin and skeletal, and the soil underfoot is like dust. Suddenly, something erupts from the tree line overhead and rolls down the slope just in front of you. It is a body. approach. You approach carefully as the body, a black elf by the look of it, bumps and batters its way down the slope to land in a rough heap. A dead body? Who's a black elf? Is that like a drow? Check it. You check the corpse. It is pretty clearly dead, though whether it was dead before being thrown down the cliffside is impossible to tell. Let's search it. You waste no time, but search the corpse's pockets. There is no gold to be had, but it does have a strange black mask strapped to the back of its head. Let's take the mask. You unstrap the black face mask from the elf and slip it into your pack. There's nothing more to be done. You are too late to help, after all. You continue along the path. You pass an inn, closed up for the daytime, before reaching a crossroads. Isn't there a spell that we can cast that has a... we use a mask? Checking, black face mask for the fear spell. Gak, G-A-K. Cool. So apparently... it's highlighted. Meaning that we can cast it. The ones in gold. Yeah. Cool. So we can cast a fear spell. Pretty neat. So continuing. Now this is the second crossroads the old man went this way. You reach a junction where three roads begin. These are the outskirts of Kharé. Huts huddle like beggars on either side of the tracks leading uphill into the city port. Let's pause to look around. It must be clear to everyone around that you are a stranger in these parts. The city's inhabitants, a multitude of malevolent creatures who would kill for the laces of your boots, turn to watch you as they pass. You are sport, a figure to be jostled and robbed, and one who will most likely fall prey to the strange elaborate system of traps laid across Kharé by the early settlers to protect themselves from one another. Yeah, probably. Look at the paths. There are more people here than you've seen in a long time. You cast an eye across the faces, wondering if you can tell the good, honest souls from the thieves and murderers. Probably not. You see no sign of the old man from the prison. He has scarpered already. Let's look left. To the left, you see a group of scruffy youngsters walking up the road with packs on their backs. Okay, look ahead. Ahead is the main road into the center of Kharé, its surface rutted from cartwheels. Further in the distance you see fields. This is the route taken by supply wagons to the docks. Let's look right. To the right you just catch a glimpse of the old man disappearing into a hut a little further up the track. The busyness of this place is confusing, but you will have to simply strike out. The north gate awaits. Just at that moment, a cart rolls down the road from the right and careens around the corner to take the main track ahead. On its back are stacked several crates. One teeters for a moment, then falls near your feet, its lid cracking open. Let's wait for the driver to stop. We'll be good. You wait for the driver to stop, but they do not see you. The cart rattles away up the road. You notice a purple liquid leaking from the side of the crate. Purple liquid. I've got to check it out, though. Look in the crate. Kneeling down in the mud, you pry open the crate with your fingers. Inside is a pile of smashed bottles. Thick purple liquid swirls about, littered with shards of glass. There are perhaps four bottles still intact, but you recognize the smell. It is blimberry, a potion with many healing properties. Huh. Now, my natural inclination is to take four bottles. But there must be a reason why we're only taking... we have an option to take two. I mean, anyone can just see us taking these bottles, right? So maybe taking two is a less crime. I'm being a little meta here in my choices. Taking two is be a less crime if we're caught, right? Something like that. Let's take two. You take two of the bottles. Wipe them down as best as you can on the grass nearby and put them into your pack. A lucky find indeed. Blimberry juice will heal you and will also do for a meal. I'm, like, automatically wishing I had taken four, actually. I'm really intrigued by the old man. I want to follow him. Let's go right. You head right, following the old man, until you reach the hut you saw him enter. It is the only building on this path that is still standing. Either side are empty plots, once the houses of the farmers who planted the fields to the north. They are now collapsed and thick with gripweed. It seems that here, in the shadow of the city wall, is not a place people choose to live. Look at the remaining hut. By the side of the door to the hut is a sign, delicately painted, Chainmaker. The door is just a crack ajar, and from within you hear a gentle tingling sound, metal on metal, as though a creature in chainmail dress was endlessly pacing the floor. Huh. Now I'm guessing if I choose look ahead, I can listen at the door after. From somewhere further on comes the falling and rising sound of a crowd. Some kind of event is taking place. There are several places you could go next. Whoa, sheesh. I still want to listen in the door. Back to the junction. Cut through the fields. Walk on. Or the Chainmaker. Well, I'm going to check it out. You push open the hut door and enter. It is dark inside. The floor is sawdust, and the air smells of oil, polish, and burnt metal. From the ceiling, hanging like ivy, are metal chains of all lengths and thickness, some suitable for machinery, some for oxen, and others for arms and feet. The chains shift and whisper to themselves. There seems to be no one here. No sign of the old man, although a second door is open in the far wall of the hut. We were hearing sounds. I guess we don't hear them anymore. Call out a greeting. Hello, is anyone there? You call. There is a shuffling beyond the far door, and then a figure emerges. It is the Chainmaker. He is Isvin, one of that race of man-orcs from the village of Torapani. You what? He replies, gruffly. You want chains? I'm looking for an old man, you declare. I saw him come in here. The Sven straightens up and chomps his jaws. No idea what you mean, he grumbles. Ain't no one here but me and my chains. You don't want a chain? You can hoof it. And he jerks a thumb at the door. Why do I want to buy a chain? You look around the shop at chain after unremarkable chain, but then one stands out. A short length of silver, which seems to move more energetically than those swaying on either side. The chain maker nods. Good chain, he says. Magic chain. What does it do? You ask. Magic, the stubborn creature replies. How much does it cost? He sizes you up, thinking you must be wealthy. It's 5 gold pieces. Let's see if we need... I'm glad I wrote all this stuff down, guys. Just want to see if there's any spell we need a chain for. We need a flute, goblin's tooth, giant's tooth. We have, actually. Vial of glue, medicinal potion, beeswax, pebble, sand, nose plugs, skull cap, black face mask, which we found just now, jewel of gold, gold back mirror, fire water, stone dust, yellow powder, gale horn, staff of oak sapling, brass pendulum, jewel studded medallion, pearl ring, bracelet of bone, green haired wig. Ring of green metal from crag and rock, crystal orb, no holy water. We don't have a lot of gold. I don't want it. You shrug. He nods. He must hear that a lot, running a chain shop. I need directions to the north gate. Can't argue with him anymore. You tell him. Can you help? Can't help. He shrugs. Not got any chains on it. Locked by a spell. Four lines. And the dumb creature holds up three fingers to demonstrate. Couldn't care less about it. There's nothing more to be gained here. You leave the hut and step back out onto the path. You have one new clue. Oh, God. I haven't played in like 3 weeks. How do I see clues again? Oh, clues. I see. The North Gate spell. The North Gate requires a spell made of four lines to be opened. Without the lines, you will not be able to leave the city port. Alright. I imagine you guys probably couldn't hear me very well over that. But yeah, we need to unlock four lines to get into the city, apparently. Let's walk on. You continue along the road. The land rises gently, a thin, meager scrub broken by rocky outcrops like teeth through an infant's gum. That's one hell of an analogy. Goats roam the slopes, paranoid, shifty creatures who flee at the sound of your footsteps. Suddenly, you could be back in the fields outside Krista Tanti. This part of the city port is barely inhabited, so you are unlikely to find clues to the North Gate spell here. There will be more people to talk to near the docks. Your stomach rumbles with hunger. Let's stop to eat. You find a low stone to perch on and rest to eat the last of your cheese and bread. That's it for our rations. You feel much better for it. Cities are deceptively tiring. Distances are always greater than you expect, and it is impossible to fall into the easy swing of a walk in the open country. It is. But we also have those two potions, guys, or whatever those are, that we can use as rations and heal us as well. I hope we find somewhere we can buy more rations, though. It's been a while. You stand to continue your journey, but then you notice something sticking out from under the rock you're sitting on. A corner of something larger? Of course I'm going to pull it free. Definitely a corner. You take hold and gently tug free a short handwritten note. It must be quite old, as the once fine paper has turned to green with mold. But shielded from the rain, the ink remains quite legible. The first line is intriguing. If you should find this, then Sansa has killed me after all. Who, Sansa? I would think it would more likely be Arya. Just kidding. Read the rest. I should have known my promotion to the position of second noble was a trap. I believe Sansa simply wanted me to enter the council chamber so he could kill me more easily. My taster found poison in the wine. I have decided to run away. But I feel his curse hounding me. He says I will never leave and never die. I hear him in my head. So I, Mulas of Kharé, commit my spell line for the North Gate to paper. But the next line is torn in half, and you cannot make out more than three words. I bid you. I will never leave and never die. Mulas of Kharé. Look under the rock for more. You spend a few minutes digging under the rock to see if you can find more of the note, but there's nothing more there. Perhaps the writer of the note never got to finish it. See, I hate how you choose one thing and that's all you can choose. See, next I would examine the paper more. You put the note fragment into your pack and continue walking along the track and begin to hear the sound of a large crowd up ahead. There is some kind of market or fair happening further on, near the river. You pass a dirt track on the left that leads away across the fields. You have found one new clue and other clues have been updated. Interesting. Four of the nobles of Kharé were each given one line of the spell to the north gate of Kharé. You will need to find these nobles if you can and learn their secrets. Lord Mulas is the second noble of Kharé. Okay, music. Alright, let's check the crowd. Hope we don't get pickpocketed. Check out this fair, right? You continue along the road towards the noise. After a few minutes, you are walking between tall poles and rippling colored flags. People and creatures sprawl across the path, and several tents have been erected. Their poles joined together by more flags. I'm not sure if that's someone's laughing or if that's some kind of animal. You ease your way into the edge of the gathered crowd. It does sound like someone laughing. This is the lady laughing too. And there's a dog barking. It all looks good, spirited, and fun, and with so many people here, perhaps you will pick up useful information about the spell lines and the city nobles. Let's look around. You look at the various events. There are a group of musicians playing a merry jig for a troupe of dancers. Elsewhere, a dwarf has raised a training bear on a lead, and on one side, watched by a hollering and cheering crowd, a ruffian is calling for challengers to take on his champion in bare-knuckle combat. It is quite a spirited affair. That's the only place we can go is the end here. Really loud now. You walk to the south end of the fairground midway. A boy with a barrel stands off to one side, and a dull-looking tent stands near the river. There are more exciting stalls further north. Well, hold on. I don't want to leave. Let's go to the barrel boy. Hey, barrel boy. You approach a boy standing by a barrel and looking sheepish. Sheepish. What are you selling? You ask. The boy points into his barrel but doesn't answer. Look in the barrel. It is full of small, hard apples. Most are blackened by disease or shot through with maggot holes. Your apples are all rotten, you remark. The boy shakes his head, then picks one up from the barrel. He squeezes it hard in his fist, but nothing happens. Then he drops it sharply back into the bucket. Why don't you speak? You ask carefully. The boy shrugs but doesn't seem to want to answer properly. What is this festival? You ask. The boy shrugs but says nothing. How much is an apple? You ask, despite the fact it's hard to imagine anyone paying for one. The boy holds up a single finger with one hand and all five fingers of the other. Six gold pieces? You declare in amazement. No one will ever pay you that. The boy rolls his eyes, thinking you must be an idiot. He holds up one finger, puts it down, then holds up five fingers on the same hand. One gold piece for five apples? The boy nods. And why not? Let's buy some. You hand over a gold piece, and the boy supplies you with five apples. In your hands, you feel that they're indeed not rotten. In fact, they are rock solid, hardened by some disease into stones. The boy bows his head in thanks, and then gestures behind him. A girl, probably his sister, pops up from behind another barrel and pulls a face at you. Should I throw it? Is that a game? I'm not sure if that's a game. I don't want to hurt her. These things are rock solid. Stick my tongue out and return. I'm thinking it's a game, but I don't want to hurt the girl in case it isn't. You stick your tongue out and reply. The girl giggles, then dodges down behind the barrel. The boy looks at you expectantly. The girl peeks up again. Is that your sister? You ask, pointing in the girl's direction. The boy nods, then takes an apple from his barrel and throws it across the field. His sister dodges quickly out of the way. Alright, let's throw an apple at her. You lob one of your apples at the girl, but she dives to one side and it misses. The boy claps his hands. The girl sticks her arms out either side, then quickly ducks. You ready your second apple and wait for the girl to show herself. As soon as she pops up, you throw, but your aim is off, and you miss by a finger's breadth or so. The girl giggles, then ducks away out of sight. Let's try another shot. You try another throw, but your aim really is terrible. Perhaps you've spent more time practicing your sword fighting and physical skills, and less learning book magic, your arm would be better. You hand back your remaining blackened apples to the boy. He grabs the apples and throws them at his sister, and you walk back onto the midway. The fair spreads out all around you. Hawkers announce the various attractions at the top of their lungs. The general atmosphere is cheerful, with just a hint of violence. Not too bad. I would have kept a couple of those apples. I guess they weren't for keeping. I'm not going to leave the fair. I'm going to go to the small tent. You approach the small tent. By the door, a young elven woman is collecting the entrance fee. One gold piece, she declares, winking at you. Huh. Notice we don't have the option to pay her at this point. What's inside? Marco the Amuser, she replies, still smiling and winking. Perhaps there's just something wrong with her other eye. He's very funny. One gold piece. Sure, why not? Let's pay her. You hand over one gold piece, and the elven woman steps aside and gestures inside the low tent. So what's this tent? The inside of the tent is dark. There are no candles or lanterns, and the cloth is thick black velvet, preventing any sunlight leaking inside. In the center of the floor, a man with green hair is sitting cross-legged, his eyes closed. Let's look at him. You look over the man. He seems ordinary enough, except for his shock of bright green hair. He doesn't seem to notice you at all. There's a deep silence inside the tent. The business of the fair outside is quite forgotten. Let's greet him. Greetings, you call out. The man doesn't move. His eyes are still closed. He seems to be breathing very deeply. Approach him. You step closer, expecting the man to leap up, or react, or in fact do anything, but he simply sits there, as you approach to within arm's reach. From here, it is clear his green hair is in fact a wig. Grab his hair. You reach out to pull off the man's wig, but he reacts like lightning, his hand snapping up to catch your wrist. That's my act, he mutters, then releases your wrist once more. What do you mean? You ask, but he does not reply. What can we cast a spell about? We're going to charm him or something? I'm not going to attack him with an offensive spell. Let's see what's available. SUS is trap. Detect trap. Wait. That's going back. Sense danger. You cast a spell, carefully checking for traps. There are none. This tent is exactly as it appears, it would seem. What else do we have? Anything starting with DTS, MD, there's quite a few. I'm going to cast Quicksand on him. Cure Wounds, Slow, Illusionary Gold, Confuse. I really want to see what would happen. What if I try Confuse, just for the hell of it? I don't know why I would do that. We don't have the option. Alright, never mind. I'm not going to attack the guy. Most of the other spells listed here are attacking in some way. Or wouldn't make any sense to use, so let's leave. Whatever is going on here, you do not understand. You step back outside, where the elven woman smiles at you. Did you enjoy? She asks. I didn't get it. Oh, really? She looks surprised. Didn't you notice his hair? It's not real. So? The elven woman looks disappointed. Oh, well. She shrugs. Everyone's sense of humor is different, I suppose. Enjoy the rest of the festival. She waves to you as you leave. From across the field comes a murmur of excitement, and then quite suddenly a small tornado lifts a tent sharply up into the air and away. Is that a tornado over here? Don't laugh at me, lady. I told you not to laugh at me. You push your way through the crowds to the very heart of the fair and look around the attractions on offer. The end. Beer tent. Dancing bear. Let's go to the beer tent. Just by the river is a low tent, surrounded by several stumbling figures. It could almost be a tent for dancing, except for the strong smell of brewed grain that drifts over the air. In the stall, a group of three half-goblin women are pouring mugs of beer and talking to the locals. A sign reads, one mug, one gold. Four mugs, six gold. Smell the air. You pause to inhale the rich smell of brewed grains that hangs around the tent. It is quite nourishing. One of the bar women catches your smile. Nice, yes, she says. Even nicer in a glass. A tall, spindly creature raises his voice to announce he is buying four mugs. A huge cheer goes up, mostly from the women behind the bar. Let's talk to the bartender lady. You elbow your way to the bar and wave to attract the attention of one of the women. Greetings, she smiles. What can I do for you? What's on sale? You ask. Oh, sweetie, sighs the half-goblin. She's a half-goblin. You can't read? We're selling beer. One gold piece for a mug and three gold pieces for four mugs. Wasn't it a different price? Just then two creatures walk past. So you say he wasn't dead when they buried him? This is the first. Not quite dead, the other replies. Enough undead, you could talk to him. Four mugs or six gold. Here she says four mugs or three gold. Let's follow the conversation. You move away from the tent to listen to the creatures. Nobles, the first creature remarks. Why can't they just stay dead when they get dead? Couldn't agree more, the other replies. But at least they buried him anyway. One less noble for the boss to worry about. The creatures disappear into the crowd. A noble who isn't quite dead? If he knows a spell line, there might be still time to learn it. A stocky dwarf knocks into you briefly. Begging your pardon, he murmurs, before slipping away into the crowd. He took gold. I only have 12 gold now. He pickpocketed me. I think he took 2 gold from me. I'm not quite sure. I think I started out with 16, and I spent 1 and then another 1, so leaving me with 14. I think he just pickpocketed 2 gold from me. And I've been checking this from time to time, seeing if gold disappears. Unfortunately, I'm not buying crap. Let's leave the tent. You don't like the look of it, so you leave the crowd and walk away from the tent. I look back. Why? Looking back, you notice a pipe running from the tent directly into the Jabaji River. It seems the beer isn't beer after all. Huh. I want to find this frickin' dwarf, man. I don't have an option for that. I'm going to keep going, guys, because we haven't reached any kind of momentous decision. So, Dancing Bear. You cross the fair to join a crowd gathered at a safe distance around a dancing bear. A dwarf stands in front of the bear, holding a lead that is fastened to a ring in the creature's nose. See my beauty dance, he growls, jerking the cord. The bear stumbles around in obvious pain. Aww. As he tugs the cable, he plays a pipe with great gusto. The crowd are in stitches of laughter at the poor bear's performance. Oh. Watch a little bit. It seems a cruel and miserable little show, but you reserve your judgment for a moment, hanging back and watching. Suddenly, a cry goes up from somewhere in the distance. My gold! My gold! Pickpocket! Beware, there is a pickpocket at work! You and the rest of the crowd spin around toward the voice and see a small creature darting off, away from the crowd, and into one of the tents. Well, let's chase... Oh, oh God! Now I'm down to 7 gold. I'm chasing him. You elbow your way through the crowd, hoping to grab the pickpocket, but there are too many people in your way. And someone else stole 5 gold. Probably this creature yelling about a pickpocket. By the time you have pushed to the edge of the crowd, the little figure has vanished. Someone shouts, "What's happening to the dwarf?" Look back at the dwarf. He's the one who stole the first set of gold. You turn to see the dwarf and bear, or maybe it's a different dwarf, disappearing into the floor, as if they were sculptures of ice now melting. Just illusions, perhaps? The crowd are out for blood now. It seems several of them have been robbed. Turning on one another, accusations of theft begin to fly this way and that. Things are turning ugly, and you are caught in the middle of it. See what I can get? Well, I'm kind of poor now, so... In the tumult, you wait for an opportunity. In every fight, there will always be some gold pouches swinging low for the plucking. You are knocked about a fair bit as you wait, but finally you see a bulging wallet just inches from your grasp. Look at the owner. Glancing up at the owner of the wallet, you find yourself staring into the huge face of a mountain man. You're a thief, are you? The man asks. Alright guys, I'm going to leave it here. You think I should run for it? Or should I try to talk my way out of it with this mountain man? I really want to get my money back. So if there's a way, you know, I don't know. Run for it to keep him from attacking us. In case he doesn't believe us that we're not a thief. At least, not yet. We were thinking about it, but we didn't actually do it, right? Or talk our way out of it. Maybe he can join us in searching for this thief, who was originally a dwarf and then this little creature who's yelling about a pickpocket, I think. No, I think he's actually innocent. It's either the original dwarf, who pickpocketed everything, or there's multiple pickpockets at work, which would not surprise me in a city like Kharé, City of Traps and all this stuff. So, yeah. What do you guys think? Should I run for the mountain man? Or try to talk my way out of it? Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode. Next week, hopefully my voice is even better. Hopefully completely recovered. That would be awesome. See you next time. And endure. In enduring, go strong.